Okay, today is the 13th of September, and we've come to Majjhima Nikaya Sutta number 10, Satipatthana Sutta. Thus have I heard, on one occasion the Blessed One was living in the Kuru country at a town of the Kurus named Kamasadama. There he addressed the monks thus, "Monks, Venerable Sir," they replied. The Blessed One said, "Monks, this is the direct path for the purification of beings, for the surmounting of sorrow and lamentation, for the disappearance of pain and grief, for the attainment of the true way, for the realization of Nibbana, namely the four Satipatthanas." Stop here for a moment. This is the direct path. This is the translation here. The Pali is Ekayana Mago, a path that leads one way only, Jalan Sahala, one way path. So in other words, it only leads you to the disappearance of dukkha, only leads you to the realization of Nibbana. And these four Satipatthanas, I like to translate it as the four intense states of sati. The reason can be found in my book, Mindfulness, Recollection and Concentration. Sati, the meaning of sati is recollection. You can translate it as mindfulness, but it is not general mindfulness. It is a specific mindfulness directed only to four objects. The body, feelings, the mind and Dhamma. So if you use the word mindfulness, sometimes people get the wrong idea. People think it's general mindfulness. It is not general mindfulness. So the word recollection is better, because recollection means recalling, bringing to mind only four objects, paying attention to only four objects, being mindful of only four objects. What are the four? Here, monks, a monk abides contemplating the body. Here it says as a body. Other places it says in the body. I think in the new translation by this Venerable Bhikkhu Bodhi of the Samyutta Nikaya, he puts the body in the body. But the best translation probably is Venerable Thanissa Rose. Abides contemplating the body in and of itself. Contemplates the body in and of itself. So the idea is that he contemplates the body in the body, not among thoughts and among other things. That means fully focus on the body. Abides contemplating the body in the body, ardent, fully aware and collected. Is fully aware and collected, sati sampajanya. Having put away covetousness and grief for the world, he abides contemplating feelings and feelings, ardent, fully aware, collected. Having put away covetousness and grief for the world, he abides contemplating mind in the mind, ardent, fully aware, collected. Having put away covetousness and grief for the world, he abides contemplating Dhamma in Dhamma, ardent, fully aware, collected. Having put away covetousness and grief for the world. So here the four Satipatthanas means contemplating these four objects, the body, feelings, mind and Dhamma, in and of itself, fully focus on these four things, or one of these four. Having put away covetousness and grief for the world, I think I explained several nights ago, that means having put away the world, because if you chase after worldly objects, either you have covetousness, you want to covet them, you want to possess them, or if you can't get them, then you have grief. So if you don't want to have these two unwholesome states of covetousness and grief, then you don't want to. You put away the world, you let go of the world, let go of worldly enjoyments. And how monks, does a monk abide contemplating the body in the body? Here a monk gone to the forest or to the root of a tree or to an empty hut sits down, having folded his legs crosswise, set his body erect, and established mindfulness in front of him. Ever mindful he breathes in, mindful he breathes out. Stop here for a moment. Establish mindfulness in front of him, that day I mentioned. That means if you set up something in front of you, you can only see it. You don't see any other thing. So if you set up mindfulness in front of you, you are only aware of mindfulness. You are not aware of any other thing. So, breathing in long, he understands, I breathe in long. Or breathing out long, he understands, I breathe out long. Breathing in short, he understands, I breathe in short. Or breathing out short, he understands, I breathe out short. He trains thus, I shall breathe in experiencing the whole body of the breath. He trains thus, I shall breathe out experiencing the whole body. He trains thus, I shall breathe in tranquilizing the body conditioner. He trains thus, I shall breathe out tranquilizing the body conditioner. Kaya Sankara. Just as a skilled turner or his apprentice, when making a long turn, understands I make a long turn. Or when making a short turn, understands I make a short turn. So too, breathing in long, a monk understands I breathe in long, etc. So here, when the breath is long, he knows, he notices that it is long. If the breath is short, he notices that it is short. And then he breathes in and out, experiencing the body. The body is the breath body. It's not the physical body, it's a breath body. And then he again says, I shall breathe in, tranquilizing the body conditioner. The body conditioner is also the breath, because the body conditioner, the body depends on breath to survive. Without the breath, the body cannot survive. So the body conditioner refers to the breath. So as he continues observing the breath, then the breath becomes more and more tranquilized, becomes calmer, becomes more tranquil. And then, just like an apprentice, he notices whether it's a long breath or short breath, etc. In this way, he abides contemplating the body in the body internally, or he abides contemplating the body in the body externally, or he abides contemplating the body in the body both internally and externally, or else he abides contemplating in the body its arising factors, or he abides contemplating in the body its vanishing factors, or he abides contemplating in the body both its arising and vanishing factors, or else mindfulness that there is a body is simply established in him to the extent necessary for bare knowledge and mindfulness or collectedness. And he abides independent, not clinging to anything in the world. That is how a monk abides contemplating the body in the body. He abides independent, not clinging to anything in the world. Because if he clings to anything in the world, then the unwholesome states of covetousness and grief arise. So when he practices the holy path, he lets go of things in the world. It's very important, otherwise you cannot progress in the spiritual path. A lot of people want to practice the spiritual path, but still cannot let go, so they cannot make much progress. And then this arising factors refers to the conditions that cause its arising. The factors that cause the origination of the body, here referring to the breath body, or the conditions. Its vanishing factors refers to the factors for its ceasing or its vanishing. And the body internally is our own body. Externally is the external bodies. Here in this case, we are talking about the breath body, but this body can refer to any body, can be the physical body also. Again, monks, when walking, a monk understands, I am walking. When standing, he understands, I am standing. When sitting, he understands, I am sitting. When lying down, he understands, I am lying down. Or he understands accordingly, however his body is disposed. In this way, he abides contemplating the body, in the body, internally, externally, and both internally and externally, etc. And he abides independent, not clinging to anything in the world. That too is how a monk abides contemplating the body in the body. And this one refers to the four postures. These four postures, generally, if you are aware of the body postures, it is in the suttas, it's generally called sampajanya. The Buddha talks about sati sampajanya. We have to practice both. Sati is recollecting the four objects of sati. Sampajanya is general mindfulness. General mindfulness, whatever your body is doing, you're aware. If you're walking, you're aware you're walking. If you're changing your clothes, you're aware you're changing your clothes. If you're eating, you're aware you're eating. Why is sampajanya practice? Because sampajanya, if you are aware of our body, then our mind does not run away. We are practicing the holy path to destroy the asavas. Asavas are uncontrolled mental outflows, the mind leaking. So when the mind flows, when the asavas flow, then our mind starts thinking here, running here, running there. We are not aware of our body. We are not aware of whatever we are doing. Our mind is straying to the office, or straying to the family, or straying to our problems and all that. So as long as you are aware of your body, the mind does not run away. So it helps to keep your mind focused. Helps to prevent, sampajanya helps to prevent the mind from flowing carelessly. So in that way, it helps us to keep our mind focused. Again, monks. A monk is one who acts in full awareness when going forward and returning, who acts in full awareness when looking ahead and looking away, who acts in full awareness when flexing and extending his limbs, who acts in full awareness when wearing his robes and carrying his outer bowl and robe, who acts in full awareness when eating, drinking, consuming food and tasting, who acts in full awareness when defecating and urinating, who acts in full awareness when walking, standing, sitting, falling asleep, waking up, talking and keeping silent. In this way, he abides contemplating the body in the body, internally, externally, and both internally and externally, etc. So this one actually is sampajanya, so being aware of all the body actions. Just now the previous one was just referring to the four postures, most specific. This one is general awareness of the body. So this is sampajanya. The fourth one, again monks, a monk reviews the same body up from the soles of the feet and down from the top of the hair, bounded by skin, as full of many kinds of impurity. Thus, in this body there are head hairs, body hairs, nails, teeth, skin, flesh, sinews, bones, bone, marrow, kidney, heart, liver, diaphragm, spleen, lungs, large intestines, small intestines, contents of the stomach, feces. There should be a brain there missing. Or maybe they put the brain at the end. Bile, phlegm, pus, blood, sweat, fat, tears, grease, spittle, snot, all of the joints, urine. Just as though there were a bag with an opening at both ends, full of many sorts of grain, such as hill rice, red rice, beans, peas, millet and white rice, and a man with good eyes were to open it and review it thus. This is hill rice, this is red rice, these are beans, these are peas, this is millet, this is white rice. So too, a monk reviews this same body as full of many kinds of impurity. Thus, in this body there are head hairs, body hairs, nails, teeth, skin, flesh, sinews, bones, etc. In this way, he abides contemplating the body in the body, internally, externally, and both internally and externally. And he abides independent, not clinging to anything in the world. That too is how a monk abides contemplating the body in the body. Let's stop here for a moment. This meditation on the 32 parts of the body that we just went through, this was the first meditation taught by the Buddha. And if you practice this, then you will notice that the body is not as attractive as we used to think. If you don't practice this type of meditation, you see the body only skin deep, see the outer looks of the body, so enticing, so attractive. But when you consider all that is inside the body, then even Miss Universe doesn't look so attractive anymore. Again, a monk reviews this same body, however it is placed, however disposed, as consisting of elements thus. In this body, there are the earth element, the water element, the fire element, and the air or wind element. Just as though a skilled butcher or his apprentice had killed a cow and was seated at the crossroads with it cut up into pieces, so too a monk reviews the same body as consisting of elements thus. In this body, there are the earth element, water element, fire element, the air element. In this way, he abides contemplating the body in the body, internally, externally, and both internally and externally. And he abides independent, not clinging to anything in the world. That too is how a monk abides contemplating the body in the body. So this is another way of contemplating the body as consisting of the four elements. The four elements are supposed to be the physical body or the physical world. And these four elements are not, when you refer to the earth element, it's not really the earth element. It refers to the hardness, the characteristic of hardness. Anything that is hard is called the earth element. The water element refers to the property of cohesion. When there's liquid, it tends to cohere together. So that refers to the water element. The fire element is the heat element. And the air or wind element is the element that causes motion, movement. So the anything in the world, in the physical world, that has any one of these characteristics are referred by these four characteristics. Again, monks, as though he were to see a corpse thrown aside in a charnel ground, 1, 2, or 3 days dead, bloated, livid, and oozing matter. A monk compares this same body with it thus. This body too is of the same nature. It will be like that. It is not exempt from that fate. So this corpse contemplation is very good. If you look at a dead corpse, it's 3 days dead. It is oozing liquid from the nine holes. And it's smelly, and it's blue-black, and all that. So it's repulsive, repulsive to see, repulsive to smell. But when you consider one day our body also will be like that. No need to be so vain about our body. Now we think it's so beautiful or so handsome, especially when we are young. But one day it will be like that. Rotten corpse, smelly, nobody wants. In this way, he abides contemplating the body in the body, internally, externally, and both internally and externally, etc. And he abides independent, not clinging to anything in the world. That too is how a monk abides contemplating the body in the body. Again, as though he were to see a corpse thrown aside in a charnel ground, being devoured by crows, hawks, vultures, dogs, jackals, or various kinds of worms. A monk compares this same body with it thus. This body too is of the same nature. It will be like that. It is not exempt from that fate. That too is how a monk abides contemplating the body in the body. Again, as though he were to see a corpse thrown aside in a charnel ground, a skeleton with flesh and blood held together with sinews, or a fleshless skeleton smeared with blood held together with sinews, or later a skeleton without flesh and blood held together with sinews, and later disconnected bones scattered in all directions Here a hand bone, there a foot bone. Here a shin bone, there a thigh bone. Here a hip bone, there a back bone. Here a rib bone, there a breast bone. Here an arm bone, there a shoulder bone. Here a neck bone, there a jaw bone. Here a tooth, there the skull. A monk compares this same body with it thus. This body too is of the same nature. It will be like that. It is not exempt from that fate. That too is how a monk abides contemplating the body in the body. Again, as though he were to see a corpse thrown aside in a charnel ground, bones bleached white, the color of shells, or later, bones heaped up more than a year old, and later, bones rotted and crumbled to dust. A monk compares this same body with it thus. This body too is of the same nature. It will be like that. It is not exempt from that fate. So this contemplation is of the different types of corpse at the various stages of decay. Initially, it's 3 days, 2 or 3 days old, it's bloated. I don't know whether you all have noticed a dead dog or a dead cow by the roadside or a dead buffalo. After a few days, you see it's bloated and there's a lot of air inside there, I think. So it seems to be like a balloon bloated up. It's so tight, the four legs are all stretched in different directions. And then after another 1 or 2 more days, you see it's collapsed already. Collapsed, and the liquid is flowing out. It's full of worms. Full of worms. All the worms are eating the flesh. Then later, you find it's very smelly. Sometimes the dog also will go and eat something. And later, you find different stages of decay. In the Buddha's days, they have this charnel ground where they throw the body in the forest, throw in the body for it to rot, for the animals to eat. So the monk who's very serious, he will go and sit at the charnel ground and contemplate. See this in the various stages of decay of the corpse. So it's quite a sobering contemplation. In this way, he abides contemplating the body in the body internally, or he abides contemplating the body in the body externally, or he abides contemplating the body in the body both internally and externally, or else he abides contemplating in the body its arising factors, or he abides contemplating in the body its vanishing factors, or he abides contemplating in the body both its arising and vanishing factors. Or else mindfulness that there is a body is simply established in him to the extent necessary for bare knowledge and mindfulness and recollection. And he abides independent, not clinging to anything in the world. That too is how a monk abides contemplating the body in the body. This contemplation of the corpse brings to mind, the Taj Mahal. Taj Mahal, we had this emperor in India. I guess he had many wives. But one was his favorite wife, must have been very young and beautiful. And this young and beautiful wife passed away. And he was so sad. He wanted to preserve the body. He clung on to the body, but after a few days it starts to get smelly. Cannot continue to cling to it. So he built this mausoleum, this Taj Mahal, to store that corpse. Nowadays, if someone were in his position, what would they do? They inject it with anesthetics, hoping that in a few hundred years' time, can revive. People cannot accept anicca. A lot of people, we know the world is impermanent, but we cannot accept. And how monks, does a monk abide contemplating feelings? In feelings. Here, when feeling a pleasant feeling, a monk understands, I feel a pleasant feeling. When feeling a painful feeling, he understands, I feel a painful feeling. When feeling a neither painful nor pleasant feeling, he understands, I feel a neither painful nor pleasant feeling. When feeling a worldly pleasant feeling, he understands, I feel a worldly pleasant feeling. When feeling an unworldly pleasant feeling, he understands, I feel an unworldly pleasant feeling. When feeling a worldly painful feeling, he understands, I feel a worldly painful feeling. When feeling an unworldly painful feeling, he understands, I feel an unworldly painful feeling. When feeling a worldly neither painful nor pleasant feeling, he understands, I feel a worldly neither painful nor pleasant feeling. When feeling an unworldly neither painful nor pleasant feeling, he understands, I feel an unworldly neither painful nor pleasant feeling. This worldly and unworldly, the other day when we were reading the Samyutta Nikaya, Venerable Bhikkhu Bodhi has changed his translation from here, worldly to unworldly. He changed to, if I remember correctly, carnal. You remember the carnal delight, carnal rapture, carnal and spiritual. Carnal and spiritual. In other words, the body feeling and the spiritual, I guess, could be the mental. In this way, he abides contemplating feelings in feelings internally, or he abides contemplating feelings in feelings externally, or he abides contemplating feelings as in feelings both internally and externally, or else he abides contemplating in feelings their arising factors, or he abides contemplating in feelings their vanishing factors, or he abides contemplating in feelings both their arising and vanishing factors, or else mindfulness that there is feeling is simply established in him to the extent necessary for bare knowledge and recollection, and he abides independent, not clinging to anything in the world. That is how a monk abides contemplating feelings in feelings. So when you contemplate feelings, whatever type of feeling arises, you know that it is such a feeling. You should also understand that it is impermanent. So because it is impermanent, you don't cling to it. So even if angry feeling arises, we know it's just an unwholesome state of mind. We just wait for it to subside. And then if you have an enjoyable feeling arising, then we should know, even though it's so enjoyable, don't cling to it, because very soon it will go away. If you cling to it, it will give you a lot of dukkha. That's why the Buddha says all feelings are basically intrinsically dukkha. Even pleasant feelings are also dukkha intrinsically, because very soon when they go away, it turns from pleasant to unpleasant. And how monks, does a monk abide contemplating mind in mind? Here a monk understands mind affected by lust as mind affected by lust, and mind unaffected by lust as mind unaffected by lust. He understands mind affected by hatred as a mind affected by hatred, and a mind unaffected by hatred as a mind unaffected by hatred. He understands a mind affected by delusion as a mind affected by delusion, and a mind unaffected by delusion as a mind unaffected by delusion. He understands a contracted mind as a contracted mind, and a distracted mind as a distracted mind. Let's stop here for a moment. If you remember the Samyutta Nikaya Suttas we studied, a contracted mind means a mind that is overcome by sloth and torpor. When you have sloth and torpor, refers to a contracted mind. A distracted mind is a mind that's distracted out to the six sense objects, to seeing, hearing, smelling, tasting, touch, and thinking. He understands an exalted mind as an exalted mind, an unexalted mind as an unexalted mind. He understands a surpassed mind as a surpassed mind, and an unsurpassed mind as an unsurpassed mind. He understands a concentrated mind as a concentrated mind, and an unconcentrated mind as an unconcentrated mind. He understands a liberated mind as a liberated mind, and an unliberated mind as an unliberated mind. In this way, he abides contemplating mind in mind internally, or he abides contemplating mind in mind externally, or he abides contemplating mind in mind both internally and externally, or else he abides contemplating in mind its arising factors, or he abides contemplating in mind its vanishing factors. or he abides contemplating in mind both its arising and vanishing factors. Or else mindfulness that there is mind is simply established in him to the extent necessary for bare knowledge and recollection, and he abides independent, not clinging to anything in the world. That is how a monk abides contemplating mind as mind. Contemplation of Dhammas. Now we come to contemplation of Dhammas. Here it says mind objects. That's a wrong translation. Because of the four objects of Sati or Satipatthana, this last one, the Dhamma, is the most important. Because there's this one sutta where the Buddha says, a person becomes liberated only under five circumstances. There are only five occasions when a monk becomes liberated, attains arahanthood. One is when he listens to the Dhamma, he understands and becomes liberated. The second one, when he's teaching the Dhamma. Third one, when he's repeating the Dhamma. The fourth, when he's reflecting on the Dhamma. And only the fifth is during meditation, when he contemplates on the Samadhi Nimitta. So you see, out of these five occasions, four of them have to do with Dhamma. And four of them actually have to do with contemplation of Dhamma. Because even when you repeat the Dhamma, you are contemplating. Because when you repeat the Dhamma, you are repeating it in a language you understand. So as soon as you understand the words, you start to digest it. That is vipassana, contemplation. So when you listen to the Dhamma, that is vipassana, that is contemplation. When you teach the Dhamma, you also have to contemplate the Dhamma before you can speak the Dhamma. That again is vipassana, that is contemplation. When you repeat the Dhamma, that is also vipassana, contemplation. When you reflect on the Dhamma, that is also vipassana, contemplation. So the samatha part is the meditation part. And the vipassana is actually nothing to do with meditation. It is just contemplation of the Dhamma. So here this last object of sati or satipatthana, it's not mind objects, but it's the Dhamma, the Buddha's Dhamma. And how monks, does a monk abide contemplating Dhamma in Dhamma? Here a monk abides contemplating Dhamma in Dhamma in terms of the five hindrances. And how does a monk abide contemplating Dhamma in Dhamma in terms of the five hindrances? Here, there being sensual desire in him, a monk understands, there is sensual desire in me. Or there being no sensual desire in him, he understands, there is no sensual desire in me. And he also understands how there comes to be the arising of unarisen sensual desire, and how there comes to be the abandoning of arisen sensual desire, and how there comes to be the future non-arising of abandoned sensual desire. Similarly, there being ill will in him, sloth and torpor, restlessness and remorse, doubt, and so monk understands, there is this hindrance in me, or there being no hindrance in him, he understands there is no hindrance in me. And he understands how there comes to be arising of the hindrance, and how there comes to be abandoning of the hindrance, and how there comes to be the future non-arising of the abandoned hindrance. In this way, he abides contemplating Dhamma in Dhamma internally, or he abides contemplating Dhamma in Dhamma externally, or he abides contemplating Dhamma in Dhamma, both internally and externally, or else he abides contemplating in Dhamma the arising factors, or he abides contemplating in Dhamma the vanishing factors, or he abides contemplating in Dhamma both the arising and vanishing factors, or else mindfulness that there is Dhamma is simply established in him to the extent necessary for bare knowledge and recollection, and he abides independent, not clinging to anything in the world. That is how a monk abides contemplating Dhamma in Dhamma in terms of the five hindrances. Again, monks, a monk abides contemplating Dhamma in Dhamma in terms of the five aggregates of attachment. And how does a monk abide contemplating Dhamma in Dhamma in terms of the five aggregates of attachment? Here, a monk understands such is material form or body, such its origin, such its disappearance, such is feeling, such its origin, such its disappearance, such is perception, such its origin, such its disappearance, such is volition, such its origin, such its disappearance, such is consciousness, such its origin, such its disappearance. In this way, he abides contemplating Dhamma in Dhamma, internally, externally, etc. These five aggregates refers to five things, body, feelings, perception, volition, and consciousness. And these five things can be also considered to be two things, body and mind. Mind consisting of the four things, feelings, perception, volition, and consciousness. Again, monks. A monk abides contemplating Dhamma in Dhamma in terms of the six internal and external bases. And how does a monk abide contemplating Dhamma in Dhamma in terms of the six internal and external bases? Here, a monk understands the I. He understands forms. He understands the factor that arises dependent on both. And he also understands how there comes to be the arising of the unarisen factor, and how there comes to be the abandoning of the arisen factor, and how there comes to be the future non-arising of the abandoned factor. Similarly, he understands the ear, he understands the nose, the tongue, the body, the mind. He understands the six bases and their objects and the factor that arises. In this way, he abides contemplating Dhamma in Dhamma, internally, externally, etc. The six bases refers to the six sense bases of eye, ear, nose, tongue, body, and mind. And the objects are the object of eyes, forms, the object of ear is sounds, etc. So, the factor that arises is the craving. The craving, when you see something beautiful, you crave for it. That is the factor. And when you hear some nice sounds, you also attach to it. That is again the factor. Similarly, for smells, tastes, etc. Again, monks. A monk abides contemplating Dhamma in Dhamma in terms of the seven enlightenment factors, bhujangas. And how does a monk abide contemplating Dhamma in Dhamma in terms of the seven enlightenment factors? Here, there being the mindfulness or recollection enlightenment factor in him, a monk understands there is the mindfulness or recollection enlightenment factor in me. Or there being no sati enlightenment factor in him, he understands there is no sati enlightenment factor in him. And he also understands that how there comes to be the arising of the unarisen sati enlightenment factor, and how the arisen sati enlightenment factor comes to fulfillment by development. There being the investigation of Dhamma enlightenment factor, Dhamma vichaya. Similarly, there being the energy enlightenment factor, there being the delight piti enlightenment factor, there being the tranquility pasadi enlightenment factor, there being the concentration samadhi enlightenment factor, there being the equanimity upekkha enlightenment factor. He understands that there is the enlightenment factor in me, he understands there is no enlightenment factor, how they arise, etc. In this way, he abides contemplating mind in mind, etc. Yeah, contemplating this Dhamma in Dhamma, etc. So these enlightenment factors, seven of them, are very important factors for enlightenment. And we went through the whole Samyutta on the Bhujangas a few days ago. Again, monks. A monk abides contemplating Dhamma in Dhamma in terms of the Four Noble Truths. And how does a monk abide contemplating Dhamma in Dhamma in terms of the Four Noble Truths? Here, a monk understands as it actually is. This is suffering. He understands as it actually is. This is the origin of suffering. And he understands as it actually is. This is the cessation of suffering. He understands as it actually is. This is the way leading to the cessation of suffering. In this way, he abides contemplating Dhamma in Dhamma internally, or he abides contemplating Dhamma in Dhamma externally, etc. This here, you look, notice here, this description of the Four Noble Truths is very short. So this sutta, this Satipatthana sutta, differs from the Maha Satipatthana sutta found in the Digha Nikaya. Only here, in the Maha Satipatthana Sutta, they explain the Four Noble Truths in greater detail. Otherwise, the rest of the sutta is exactly the same between the Satipatthana Sutta found in the Majjhima Nikaya and the Maha Satipatthana Sutta found in the Digha Nikaya. In the Digha Nikaya, when they explain the Four Noble Truths in detail, they explain suffering, they explain the origin of suffering, the cessation of suffering, the path leading to the cessation of suffering. And then in the Noble Eightfold Path, the explanation of the Noble Eightfold Path, when it comes to right concentration, it is stated in the Maha Satipatthana Sutta that right concentration refers to the four jhanas. Everywhere in the suttas, when the Buddha talks about right concentration or perfect concentration, he always refers to the four jhanas. But nowadays, people misinterpret and say that concentration can refer to momentary concentration, kanika samadhi. This word kanika samadhi, the Buddha never heard it also, never used it. So it is something that developed later. In the Buddha's teachings, samadhi always refers to the jhanas. Monks, if anyone should develop these four satipatthanas, intense states of recollection, in such a way for 7 years, one of two fruits could be expected for him, either final knowledge here and now, or that if there is a trace of clinging left, non-return. Let alone 7 years, monks, if anyone should develop these four intense states of recollection in such a way for 6 years, or for 5 years, 4 years, 3 years, 2 years, 1 year, one of two fruits could be expected for him, either final knowledge here and now, or if there is a trace of clinging left, non-return. Let alone 1 year, monks, if anyone should develop these four intense states of recollection in such a way for 7 months, for 6 months, 5 months, 4 months, 3 months, 2 months, 1 month, for half a month, one of two fruits could be expected for him, either final knowledge here and now, or if there is a trace of clinging left, non-return. Let alone half a month, monks, if anyone should develop these four intense states of recollection in such a way for 7 days, one of two fruits could be expected for him, either final knowledge here and now, or if there is a trace of clinging left, non-return. So it was with reference to this that it was said, monks, this is the direct path, or this is the path leading one way only, for the purification of beings, for the surmounting of sorrow and lamentation, for the disappearance of pain and grief, for the attainment of the true way, for the realization of Nibbana, namely the four intense states of recollection. This is what the Blessed One said. The monks were satisfied and delighted in the Blessed One's words. So in this last part, the Buddha says, if a monk practices the four satipatthanas correctly, even for 7 days, in 7 days' time, he can become liberated, become enlightened. So that can only happen if the sati is unremitting sati. Every second, the mindfulness does not stray, does not weaken, does not run away. So that's why it's called intense state of recollection. So intense that it is not, there's no let up. So in the our Buddha, among our Buddha's disciples, we know of only one, Venerable Mahamoggallana, who attained liberation in 7 days. He practiced 7 days. He practiced strenuously for 7 days, and he became enlightened in such a short time. But that was possible only with the help of the Buddha, because mentioned in the Samyutta Nikaya that we read, when he entered in the first jhana, because he was practicing so hard, he didn't take rest, you see. So he was so sleepy that he fell out of the first jhana. When that happened, the Buddha came to him and asked him to be more mindful, don't be nodding. Then he knew that the Buddha was observing him, then used more energy, and he could stay in the first jhana. And after that, he could enter the second jhana. But because also of the same reason, he was so tired that he was nodding his head and coming out of the second jhana. Again, the Buddha went to him and reminded him, and again he used more effort and could abide steady in the second jhana. After that, similarly for the third jhana, fourth jhana, and the other jhanas, until his mindfulness was unremitting, no let up in his mindfulness, no sleep for 7 days and nights, no sleep until he became enlightened. So nowadays, what is being practiced now, without that samadhi, it's impossible to become enlightened in 7 days. Not to say 7 days, even 7 years or 70 years, without the strong samadhi, you cannot become enlightened at all. Recap what the Buddha said on the Satipatthana Sutta. This Satipatthana Sutta, it doesn't teach you exactly how to practice sati, you know. It just tells you the objects of sati, contemplating the body. Is firstly, it says, to practice Satipatthana, you got to contemplate four things, body, feelings, mind, and Dhamma. And then the first one, the body, it tells you the various types of bodies that you can contemplate. First one is the breath body, then after that the four postures, then after that awareness. Awareness actually is sampajanya, awareness of your body, actions. And number four is the unattractiveness of the body and the 32 parts of the body. And then after that, the four elements. The fifth is the four elements. And then the 6th to the 14th object is the skeleton contemplation, the different types of skeleton. So there are 14 objects in the body. Then contemplation of feelings, there's only one. Whenever feelings arise and cease, you have to be mindful of it. Then contemplating of mind, the state of the mind, whether it's a lustful mind or an angry mind or whatever, be aware of it. I think this contemplation of mind, you can include also the thoughts, whatever thoughts arise, you have to be aware. But instead of following the thoughts, you don't follow the thoughts. If you follow the thoughts, you keep thinking, then you are no more mindful. Instead, you have to observe why you think in a certain way. What is your motive? And we look at the motive behind our thoughts, behind our reactions. Then we understand ourselves better, whether we have a big fat ego or we have a lot of anger or whatever, we have a lot of greed. So it's only by understanding yourself that you can change. If you don't understand yourself, how can you change, how can you improve? That's why in the Noble Eightfold Path, the sixth factor, Right effort is to always observe whether you have unwholesome states of mind or wholesome states of mind. In the same way, whatever thoughts that come to your mind also, you should understand whether they are wholesome or unwholesome. And the contemplation of dhammas is to contemplate those dhammas that are very important in the Buddha's teachings. First one is the five hindrances. How the five hindrances hinder us from having wisdom. So we should try to get rid of them by meditation. And the five aggregates of attachment, this is an extremely important topic. Found in the Kanda Samyutta, in the Samyutta Nikaya. Then the six bases. The six bases is the Salayatana Samyutta in the Samyutta Nikaya. And then the seven enlightenment factors is the Bojanga Samyutta in the Samyutta Nikaya. And then the four noble truths is the Satcha Samyutta in the Samyutta Nikaya. So the Samyutta Nikaya is a very, very important, to me, the most important Nikaya. It tells you exactly how to practice Satipatthana, how to practice the seven Bojangas, etc. Whereas this Sutta, this Satipatthana Sutta, just tells you the objects of Sati. It doesn't explain exactly what is the meaning of Sati or Satipatthana and how to practice. Okay, let's try to go through the 11th sutta. Chula Sihanada Sutta, the shorter discourse on the lion's roar. Thus have I heard. On one occasion, the Blessed One was living at Savati in Jeta's Grove, another Pindika's park. There he addressed the monks thus, "Monks, Venerable Sir," they replied. The Blessed One said, "Monks, only here is there a recluse, a Samana, I think. Only here a second recluse, only here a third recluse, only here a fourth recluse. The doctrines of others are devoid of recluses. That is how you should rightly roar your lion's roar." So here the Buddha is saying, only in the Buddha's teachings, in the Buddha Sasana, you have the first, second and third recluse, the first, second and third real monk. I suppose he says, first here, first, second, third and fourth, maybe refers to the four types of fruits, fruitions, the Sotapanna, Sakadagamin, Anagamin and Arahanna. It is possible, monks, that wanderers of other sects might ask, but on the strength of what argument or with the support of what authority do the Venerable Ones say thus? Wanderers of other sects who ask thus may be answered in this way. Friends, four things have been declared to us by the Blessed One who knows and sees, accomplished and fully enlightened. This is Arahan Sammasambuddha. On seeing these in ourselves, we say, only here is there a recluse, only here a second recluse, only here a third recluse, only here a fourth recluse. The doctrines of others are devoid of recluses. What are the four? We have confidence in the teacher, that means the Buddha. We have confidence in the Dhamma. We have fulfilled the precepts, and our companions in the Dhamma are dear and agreeable to us, whether they are laymen or those gone forth. These are the four things declared to us by the Blessed One who knows and sees, accomplished and fully enlightened, on seeing which in ourselves we say as we do. So the Buddha says, there are four things that they possess. They have confidence in the Buddha, the Dhamma, and they keep the Aryan precepts, and the companions in the Dhamma are dear to them. It is possible, monks, that wanderers of other sects might say thus, "Friends, we too have confidence in the teacher, that is, in our teacher. We too have confidence in the Dhamma, that is, in our Dhamma. We too have fulfilled the precepts, that is, our precepts. And our companions in the Dhamma are dear and agreeable to us too, whether they are laymen or those gone forth." What is the distinction here, friends? What is the variance? What is the difference between you and us? Wanderers of other sects who ask thus may be answered in this way. How then, friends, is the goal one or many? That means, is the object one or many? Answering rightly, the wanderers of other sects would answer thus, "Friends, the goal is one, not many. But friends, is that goal for one affected by lust or free from lust?" Answering rightly, the wanderers of other sects would answer thus, "Friends, that goal is one for the goal is for one free from lust, not for one affected by lust. But friends, is that goal for one affected by hate or free from hate?" Answering rightly, they would answer, "Friends, that goal is for one free from hate, not for one affected by hate. But friends, is that goal for one affected by delusion or free from delusion?" Answering rightly, they would answer, "Friends, that goal is for one free from delusion, not for one affected by delusion. But friends, is that goal for one affected by craving or free from craving?" Answering rightly, they would answer, "Friends, that goal is for one free from craving, not for one affected by craving. But friends, is that goal for one affected by clinging, attachment, or free from clinging?" Answering rightly, they would answer, "Friends, that goal is for one free from clinging, not for one affected by clinging. But friends, is that goal for one who has vision or for one without vision?" Answering rightly, they would answer, "Friends, that goal is for one with vision, not for one without vision. But friends, is that goal for one who favors and opposes, or for one who does not favor and oppose?" Answering rightly, they would answer, "Friends, that goal is for one who does not favor and oppose, not for one who favors and opposes. But friends, is that goal for one who delights in and enjoys proliferation, or for one who does not delight in and enjoy proliferation?" Answering rightly, they would answer, "Friends, that goal is for one who does not delight in and enjoy proliferation, not for one who delights in and enjoys proliferation." Here, proliferation is papancha, means proliferation of thoughts. Monks, there are these two views, the view of being and the view of non-being. Any recluses or Brahmins who rely on the view of being, adopt the view of being, accept the view of being, are opposed to the view of non-being. Any recluses or Brahmins who rely on the view of non-being, adopt the view of non-being, accept the view of non-being, are opposed to the view of being. Any recluses or Brahmins who do not understand as they actually are, the origin, the disappearance, the gratification, the danger, and the escape, in the case of these two views, are affected by lust, hatred, delusion, affected by craving, clinging, without vision, given to favoring and opposing, and they delight in and enjoy proliferation. They are not free from birth, aging, and death, from sorrow, lamentation, pain, grief, and despair. They are not free from suffering, I say. Any recluses or Brahmins who understand as they actually are, the origin, the disappearance, the gratification, the danger, and the escape, in the case of these two views, are without lust, without hate, without delusion, without craving, clinging, with vision, not given to favoring and opposing, and they do not delight in and enjoy proliferation. They are freed from birth, aging, and death, from sorrow, lamentation, pain, grief, and despair. They are freed from suffering, I say. Monks, there are these four kinds of clinging. What for? Clinging to sensual pleasures, clinging to views, clinging to rules and observances, and clinging to a doctrine of a self. Though certain recluses and Brahmins claim to propound the full understanding of all kinds of clinging, they do not completely describe the full understanding of all kinds of clinging. They describe the full understanding of clinging to sensual pleasures without describing the full understanding of clinging to views, clinging to rules and observances, and clinging to a doctrine of self. Why is that? Those good recluses and Brahmins do not understand these three instances of clinging as they actually are. Therefore, though they claim to propound the full understanding of all kinds of clinging, they describe only the full understanding of clinging to sensual pleasures without describing the full understanding of clinging to views, clinging to rules and observances, and clinging to a doctrine of self. Though certain recluses and Brahmins claim to propound the full understanding of all kinds of clinging, they describe the full understanding of clinging to sensual pleasures and clinging to views without describing the full understanding of clinging to rules and observances and clinging to a doctrine of self. Why is that? They do not understand the two instances. Therefore, they describe only the full understanding of clinging to sensual pleasures and views. Though certain recluses and Brahmins claim to propound the full understanding of all kinds of clinging, they describe the full understanding of clinging to sensual pleasures, clinging to views, and clinging to rules and observances without describing the full understanding of clinging to the doctrine of self. Because in such monks, in such a Dhamma Vinaya as that, it is plain that confidence in the teacher is not rightly directed, that confidence in the Dhamma is not rightly directed, that fulfillment of the precepts is not rightly directed, and that the affection among companions in the holy life is not rightly directed. Why is that? Because that is how it is when the Dhamma Vinaya is badly proclaimed and badly expounded, unemancipating, unconducive to peace, expounded by one who is not fully enlightened. Monks, when a Tathagata, Arahant Sammasambuddha, claims to propound the full understanding of all kinds of clinging, he completely describes the full understanding of all kinds of clinging. He describes the full understanding of clinging to sensual pleasures, views, rules and observances, and to a doctrine of self. Monks, in such a Dhamma Vinaya as that, it is plain that confidence in the teacher is rightly directed, that confidence in the Dhamma is rightly directed, that fulfillment of the precepts is rightly directed, and that the affection among companions in the Dhamma is rightly directed. Why is that? Because that is how it is when the Dhamma Vinaya is well proclaimed and well expounded, emancipating, conducive to peace, expounded by one who is fully enlightened. Now these four kinds of clinging have what as their source, what as their origin, from what are they born and produced. These four kinds of clinging have craving as their source, craving as their origin. They are born and produced from craving. Craving has what as its source. Craving has feeling as its source. Feeling has what as its source. Feeling has contact as its source. Contact has what as its source. Contact has the sixfold base as its source. The sixfold base has what as its source. The sixfold base has nama rupa, mentality, materiality as its source. Mentality, materiality has what as its source. Mentality, materiality has consciousness as its source. Consciousness has what as its source. Consciousness has volition as its source. Volition has what as its source. Volition has ignorance as its source. Ignorance as its origin. It is born and produced from ignorance. Monks, when ignorance is abandoned and true knowledge has arisen in a monk, then with the fading away of ignorance and the arising of true knowledge, he no longer clings to sensual pleasures, no longer clings to views, no longer clings to rules and observances, no longer clings to a doctrine of a self. When he does not cling, he is not agitated. When he is not agitated, he personally attains Nibbana. He understands birth is destroyed. The holy life has been lived. What had to be done has been done. There is no more coming to any state of being. That is what the Blessed One said. The monks were satisfied and delighted in the Blessed One's words. So in this sutta, the Buddha says the real recluse or the real monk is only found in the Buddha's Dhamma Vinaya, in the Buddha's teachings. And then if the external sect ascetics say that they also are similar, then the Buddha says, but their Dhamma Vinaya is different. So even these four things that they claim to have, confidence in the teacher, confidence in the Dhamma, they have the precepts and they love their companions in the holy life. Even that is faulty because the Dhamma Vinaya is faulty. Then the Buddha says, talks about the four kinds of attachment or clinging, clinging to sensual pleasures, clinging to views, clinging to rules and observances, and clinging to a doctrine of a self. The Buddha says, these external sect ascetics, they are not able to explain these four types of clinging in detail. They might be able to explain one, or explain two, or explain three, but they are not able to explain all four correctly and in detail. Then after that, the Buddha says, clinging, the source of clinging is craving, source of craving is feeling, etc., just like in the dependent origination suttas. So that's the end of the sutta for tonight. Anything to discuss? Source of the fear is our I am, the being. Once you have a perception that the I exists, then you are always afraid that this I may be harmed in any way. That's why all our fears arise, because of that self. If there is no self, then there is no fear. That's why the Buddha says, an arahant, because he has no self, if you took a dagger, you wanted to stab an arahant, he will not shout for help. He does not see a self in this body. Even if you were to kill him, he would accept it as his karma.
Let's say after meditation, you feel that you are practicing, but it doesn't have overcome our fear, maybe there's something wrong with our meditation.
So you have to switch on to asubha or the two parts. Or the other hand, if you're contented and never to get clear, so how are we going to balance in the day?
You see, if you practice meditation correctly, it doesn't matter what is your object that you contemplate on, your meditation. But the aim of meditation is to attain the jhanas, to attain one pointedness of mind, to attain a focused mind. When the mind attains samadhi, there is strength in the mind. When there is strength in the mind, it doesn't move so easily. So it is not so much affected by fear or by sensual pleasures or enjoyment, anything. Even dukkha, it is not so much affected because it has a firm foundation, it has a firm base. So samadhi is very important, strength of mind. And understanding of the Dhamma also. If you have understanding of the Dhamma, then certain things we can accept. Like seeing these corpses and all that, although they are revolting, but the only way to overcome it is to see it again and again. You cannot say, oh, because it's revolting, I don't want to see it. Maybe when my samadhi is strong, then maybe I can see. Don't wait. You have to start getting used to it by seeing it. The other day, I understand they showed this asubha, this VCD, on how they kill people and all that. And then one of our brothers, after seeing that, he couldn't sleep for a few nights. And he ran away home, went home for a few days before he came back. So, you see, this although this thing is revolting, hard to see, hard to stomach, but it's a fact of life. Life is like that. Life is really very cruel. So we have to come to terms with it. We have to face it. I always like to quote this, that when I was young, I had this fear of the darkness because my parents brought me to see a Pontianak show. Ghost show. It was so frightening. That after I came back, every night I had a nightmare for 7 nights. Every night. I woke up sweating all over. And from there, I got a fear of the dark. After I became a monk, and then I went to Thailand, and I came back from Thailand in 1987, I went to look for caves to stay in Ipoh area. I couldn't find a good cave. All the good caves are taken up by people, by fortune tellers and by this and that. So some devotees went looking for me, and they found this dark cave behind Simpang Polai, a very dark and huge cave, bigger than this hall. It seems during the Japanese occupation, when the Second World War, about 200 girls are hid in that cave. They were afraid of being raped by the Japanese soldiers. So they hid in that cave. So that was the best cave I had. So because it was very quiet, I went to stay there. But it's very frightening. I could the first two nights I did not stay inside. I stayed outside. But then I had a dream that told me that I would be safe if I went inside the cave. Some devas appeared to me in the dream. So after that, I went to stay inside the cave. But it was so dark, I had to light an oil lamp. And sometimes some curious people came looking for me. I just blow off the oil lamp. I stand behind the rock. They look and look. They can't see anybody. So dark. So from there, I stayed there 4 months. Slowly, I overcame the fear of darkness. So it's like this. You want to overcome some shortcoming in you, you have to face it head on. You cannot run away. You keep running away until you die, so you'll never overcome your fear.
Just
Yeah, I mean, don't worry about your meditation not being up to standard. If you have, for example, a photo of a cut-up corpse, then once in a while you peep at it, you're afraid, you put it away, and you peep at it again, you keep peeping until you get used to it. Yeah.
Not necessary.
But if you are a person with a lot of lust, then it is advisable to contemplate on the corpse. You see, in the Noble Eightfold Path, the seventh factor is Samma Sati, right? Right recollection. The eighth factor is Samma Samadhi, right concentration. Now the seventh factor is only Samma Sati. It's not Satipatthana, you know. A lot of people think that Sati and Satipatthana is the same. It's different. Sati and Satipatthana is different. Sati is contemplating these four things. You can contemplate all four, or you can contemplate one of them. And you do this contemplation whenever convenient. For example, when you're sitting in a bus, as there's nothing to do, when you're taking a stroll, you just reflect on the Dhamma and you think of these four objects. You observe your mind, observe your feelings, and then remember the Dhamma that you have learned, and then observe your body and think of the nature of your body, how you're getting old, how 5 years ago you didn't have arthritis, now you got arthritis here and there. So then you realize the nature of the body, and you contemplate, if you like, on the corpse, how you're going to end up as a corpse, and all this. So that is Sati. But Satipatthana is different. Satipatthana, the example given in the Samyutta Nikaya on how to practice Satipatthana, was this man who was forced to carry a bowl of oil, among a great crowd of people. And a man followed him behind with an uplifted sword and told him, if you spill even one drop of the oil, I'll chop off your head. So this man holding the bowl of oil, he has to be very mindful that he does not spill even one drop of oil. So he is walking with all his attention focused on that bowl of oil. That is how to practice Satipatthana. And it's also mentioned very clearly in the Satipatthana Samyutta, when the Buddha talked about the simile of the cook, the skillful monk who practices Satipatthana, that means the one who practices Satipatthana in the correct way, ends up with getting concentration. If he does not get concentration, then he's unskillful. He has not obtained the objective of practice Satipatthana. The objective of practicing Satipatthana is to attain the jhanas. That is the end result. So Satipatthana is the link between Samma Sati and Samma Samadhi. After you practice Sati already, then you focus your attention on one object, for example your breath, and as much as you can, put your attention on the breath, that one object. Like in the Buddha's for the Buddha's disciples, they put their attention on the breath 24 hours a day. Even when they rest also, they have unremitting mindfulness on the breath until they are able to maintain their mindfulness 24 hours a day. Then they attain arahanthood. And then after that, the Buddha says in the Vinaya books that all arahants have mindfulness 24 hours a day. That's why they cannot do anything wrong. They cannot commit any fault, any break, any precept. So So for an arahant to be mindful 24 hours a day, he must have practiced to the extent that he could maintain his mindfulness 24 hours. So you cannot do that type of practice, maintain your unremitting mindfulness without samadhi. Without samadhi, you try to be mindful, very soon you'll be falling asleep. So that is the difference between sati and satipatthana. Satipatthana is the intense state of recollection, unremitting mindfulness on one object, moment to moment to moment to moment, and only one object, until it turns into one-pointedness of mind. That's why the Venerable Anuruddha, he was asked, what did you practice to attain such great supernormal powers? And he said satipatthana, intense state of recollection.
See the singing of the cook who knows his master. Actually, the cook and the master will eventually be the same degree. Can the same appointments of the mind, isn't it?
Say again.
The cook and the master. Actually, the master is the mind, and the cook is the awareness. Eventually, if we are able to control our mind, and which the cook is the master.
Yeah, but in this simile, it says that the cook has to observe the master's preference. So in the same way, when we are meditating, we have to observe what the mind inclines to. What the mind, like the type of meditation object that the mind likes, and the type of conditions that the mind likes, like the place, the surroundings, the environment and all that.
Yes.
You have to be very observant of yourself. Come, we end here.